children, just like you saw in the video with Pujols, especially boys, want to be like their father. It's automatic. This is the way God has designed it. It's not something that you have to create. It is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in the law doeth he meditate day and night. Number 7, in the Bible, the book of Deuteronomy stresses the importance of teaching when you sit at home, when you walk around the road. We are instructed to tie God's principles, men, fathers, to our hands and bind them on our foreheads. It's amazing to me that Brother Pozo read that scripture he did today. As a man of God, it is imperative that you have scripture around your home. It is important that you utilize every means at your disposal to teach your children about God, fathers. It is imperative that you teach your children the way of the Lord. You want to keep your, I tell mothers all the time, oh, you want to keep your children out of gang activity, life stuff like that, because I used to live that kind of stuff. I understand I'm from that kind of place in life, in and out of jail. That's when I embarrassed my mother, took her through turmoil. It just devastated my mom at how I turned out. Thank God I got saved. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
But it could have been prevented. Had my father been a man in the house that taught me prayer, that taught me reading the scripture. Men, teach your children. The minute they can read, the minute they learn how to read, you may be busy. You may be on 2-3 jobs. You may be tired coming home when you get off work at 11 o'clock at night. Listen to me, guys. Fathers. You get off 11 o'clock. I'm talking about the father that lives in the house. That's married. Need to kind of break it down sometime in this society we live in. Can I keep it 100? Amen. Fathers that are married living in the house. Amen. Now, understand there are some fathers who have separation. This is society to do. They're separated. But still, call the child. Now, for the father that's in the house, you get home 11 o'clock at night. I understand you're tired. I understand you're busy. Go in the room while the baby is asleep. The little boy is asleep, 5, 7 years old. He may be 12, maybe 15. Lay your hand on his head. Father, in the name of Jesus, I bless my seed. Oh. Oh, come on, somebody. I want to say to you fathers that are husbands too. You know, Sister Turner doesn't know it all the time. She's sleeping. I just come in, lay my hands on her. Bless. In Jesus' name. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
What's wrong with that? Do people have to be always awake for you to bless them? I never read that in the scripture. They have to be coherent to understand you bless or hear you bless them. You can bless them while they're asleep. Y'all pray for me while I'm sleeping.
Amen.
Some of you up 2 o'clock in the morning? Father, right now, pastor's probably asleep, but bless him. Bless his dreams right now. Amen. I covet your prayers. Is that all right?
Amen.
Praise God. Fathers are very important in molding the lives of children. Now let me turn this and then I'm going to close. I'll get right to this. What is a father? What is he? What is it? I love how Deacon Manozian said, boy, I was very excited when I became a father. I'm excited for him being a father. I look at Leon and I just marvel at his family, his fatherhood, how faith runs to him. God bless you, man. Amen. Can we praise the Lord for him? What is a father? A father in today's society is a single mother and a male father. But the single mothers, you got to father up. It's unfortunate. It's not fair. But it is what it is. Say it with me. It is what it is. Until the father shows up, you got to carry the torch. But I want to talk to the male side, the male fathers today, the father-in-laws, the stepfather, the adopted father, any male ancestor. This is what a father is. He's also a founder of a race, a culture, a founder of a family. Abraham was like that. He's the father of faith. He's the father of Gentiles. That's who Abraham is. A man who exercises paternal care over other persons is a father. A paternal protector or provider is a father. A provider to the poor, such as things like that. He's a father. A Christ-driven spiritual leader to others in the faith. The word denotes strength, amen, security, provision, safety, even sincerity, leadership, peaceful environment, stability, undistorted intimacy. You know what undistorted intimacy is? Having your children walk around you and you never tell them you love them. You never say it. Say it, everybody. Especially the men. Tell your children you love them. Amen. The word also denotes direction. The word also denotes habitation, honesty. And most importantly, to be a father is to be loving. And the lovingness of a father is not to be in love, but to demonstrate love. Well, that's a big difference. And I just want to give a side note on this. One of the profound things about a biblical dad is that it is possible to do it. It's also impossible for him to not be concerned about his family or his children. It's impossible to be a father and not be concerned about your children. It's impossible for him to not care or to not demonstrate his love to his children. A true father cannot divorce his feelings from his children. They're always on his mind. Second note, this is why Jesus introduced us to the new side of God, the main father. Before Jesus came and broke us off how to pray, amen, thank the Lord, they wouldn't even speak his name. The Hebrew culture was so in reverence and fear of who he was, they would not utter his name at all. The one, he that sits above, looks low. This is the way they would describe the Father. No one ever discussed. We'd have no intimacy. He that created the world, he that is always around, he that has all power, he that has created everything. But then Jesus comes on the scene and he ushers us into the Father and says, when you pray, I pray this way. Father! Jesus. Yeah, you know that now. You know, you're not allowed to sit in that thing unless you totally respect it. Amen. That's where they recline, watch the game and everything. I go with Papa Benozzi's. Pastor, have a seat. Don't mind if I do, Papa. The reason why I'm happy to sit there is because he has given me the blessing. So I'm receiving the blessing as sonship because of that. I receive all blessings. Amen. But the thing that amazes me, do you know Papa Benozzi, he kisses Deacon Benozzi? Papa Pozo kisses Papa, or Deacon Pozo. He kisses him. Amen. I kiss, yes, kiss all the little teenager fellows around me. I kiss them. I don't get nervous. Amen. I'm not talking to inappropriate. I kiss them on the top of their head or something like that, or on the side of their little forehead. I kiss them. I want them to know this pastor loves you. Amen. Amen. The little babies and everything, I want them to know. Look at me. Look, I love you. Get the eye contact, fellas. Amen. That's what goes in the memory. You start downloading the memories when you do that. They remember this. Amen. Be a kissing dad. I'm just about through. Praise the Lord. This is the very thing that the Father is no longer just a God of majesty, a God of power, but he's now the Father, a God of relationship and intimacy with his creation. Amen. Be a good role model. Now I want to take you to the Word of God. Can you come with me to Genesis? I want to wrap this up real quick. And Brother Deacon Pozo, can you bring that chair? Put this chair right here for me. I would put it down here, but I want everybody to see this example. I saw this in the scripture. It just blew my mind. I was just reading this to go to another area that I was going to speak about today, and I saw it. I began to read it, and the Spirit of God moved on my heart, and the thing just leaped out at me, and I was like, what? Oh my goodness, I couldn't believe it was in the Word of God. Genesis 47:27, it says, and Israel dwelt in the land of Egypt. Israel now is Jacob, whose name was changed by God to Israel. It says, in the country of Goshen, And they had possessions therein, and they grew and multiplied exceedingly. And Jacob lived in the land of Egypt 17 years. So the whole age of Jacob was 147 years. Now look at verse 29. And the time drew nigh that Israel must die, meaning Jacob, who's changed his name, God changed his name to Israel. And he called his son Joseph and said unto him, if now I have found grace in thy sight, put, I pray thee, thy hand under my thigh and deal kindly and truly with me. Bury me not, I pray thee, in Egypt. Now, this is a very strange scripture. As it turns out, I have found out that there was a tradition in the Hebrew culture of fathers. When they were about to leave, they would call the seed, the son, that was the one that had the next in line in inheritance. Now, this is not practiced in America, but I just want you to hold on to see the God effect of this thing. Amen. The God factor. Can you say that with me? The God factor. Not Godfather. The God factor. Amen. F-A-C-T-O-R. Is that all right? And what would happen is that the Hebrew fathers would sit down in a chair. Now, I'm going to give you an example. Father, can you help me, please? Could you come? Help me. Father, come on up and sit here for me. Praise God. The reason I'm using Papa is because he's elderly. He's an elder father of our church, one of the elder fathers of our church. Amen. Papa, I wish I get to preach in Nikes and stuff like that. Yeah, good. Have a seat. Now, what would happen with this? I want to show this to you. This is beautiful, man. I was so grateful to the Lord. I said, Lord, wow, I can't wait till Sunday. What would happen is the father would say, when he was about to leave, the Lord had let the father know in the Hebrew culture, I'm getting ready to bring you home. Now, as you can see here, Jacob lived 17 years old, age of the time he was there, 147 years. I speak that over you, sir.
Amen.
Yes, sir. Yeah, he didn't, no, I don't know that I want to be here that long. Okay. Amen. Amen. Well, I just put it this way. At least go past the 100. He don't want to do the 100 either. Amen. I'm trying to bless you, Papa. Yeah. But anyway, all right. Say I'm a son, which I'm a son to this precious man here. I'm a son. So what the family would do is when they wanted to bless the seed that was, those children that were going to receive the inheritance, the son would have to come to the father, kneel to the right, to the left side here, okay, on the left side, and slide his hand right under the thigh here. Okay? Everybody with me? He would put the hand here. Now, when this would happen, the father would then raise the right hand and speak the blessing. Now, thank you, Father. Thank you, sir. Thank you, thank you. He told me anytime. He'll bless me anytime. Amen. Can we give the Lord a hand praise for Father? Hallelujah. Praise God. Now that I show you this, here's the significance of this. The hand going under the thigh, see, in this society we live in America, in this society we live in, this would seem to be dysfunctional or inordinate. You follow me? In fact, if you walked into someone's house today and you saw a man's son putting his hand under the father's thigh, I can imagine some of the thoughts that you would be having in your mind. Okay? But this, you just read it in the Bible. Now, what was going on with this is, it was important to God, in the Hebrew culture, that sons submit themselves to their fathers and respect the eldership and reverence the leadership in the house. So they were to be brought low, extend their hand under the thigh to demonstrate, you are approved of me. I respect you as my elder. You are my father. I submit to you that you are the blessing to my life. And in return, the father would then take the right hand, which represents the power of God, and begin to decree over the son and speak blessings over the father. This would happen in two situations. Either the father would be sitting down, or the father would be not able to sit because of difficulty in the health and the son would come to the bed and slide the hand under the thigh. There's other references about this in the scripture, everybody. Now, turn with me, I'm going to show you something that's very interesting. Turn with me to Genesis, the 32nd chapter. Now I'm coming home, we'll finish up. Genesis 32:24, and it says, and Jacob was left alone, and there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day. This is when Jacob wrestled with that angel, which was truly a representative of Jesus. Actually, I don't have time to speak on it, but it actually was Jesus. In the form, the angel was used, but the significance of the presence was the day star, which is another name for Jesus. Amen. So it says here, Jacob left and alone, and there wrestled with him a man until the breaking of the day. And when he saw, he prevailed not against him. He touched the hollow of his thigh. And the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint, and he wrestled with him. And he said, let me go, for the day breaketh. And he said, I will not let thee go, except thou bless me. And he said unto him, what is thy name? And he said, Jacob. The angel did not ask Jacob what his name was, because he didn't know his name. He asked Jacob what his name was, so that Jacob would look at himself. Amen. The whole purpose of going under the thigh is also that the child understands who they are. You're respecting the bloodline that I'm in. I submit my hand under the thigh, acknowledging the bloodline I am from is approved of God. Amen. When is a man's bloodline approved of God? Good question. When the Father says it. Every time you say it, the minute you speak it, it's approved of God. It can be said that in the families today, particularly in America, a lot of the dysfunction with children that are being raised today is because the father has a muzzle. He won't speak blessing. Remember, everybody, the Bible says that life is in the power of. Life is in the power of. Speak life to your children. Amen, fellas. Amen. Amen, you single mothers who are fathers. Speak life. Amen. Amen. By the way, special note to the mothers. I wanted to say this. Since Marilyn and I have been pastoring at New Hope, I'm talking about Father's Day. One thing I've never shared with the church, but I'm gonna let you in on a little secret. It is unusual. I've discussed this with a few of the sisters. I've called you just to ask questions because I wanted to learn more about various cultures. But it's ironic to me that many women that come up for prayer, they ask for one thing, and I understand that, but then the Lord will allow a discernment to take place. And do you know the number one thing that I pick up? I'm just letting you know. It's the spirit of rejection. Now, you may not understand what I just said, but I'm going to explain it to you. Many daughters of him that have come, guests, family, friends, have been rejected by their mothers and their fathers. And they don't even know they've been walking around with this. How does it manifest? Broken relationships, carnage of miles in the past, broken relationships. All because there wasn't a father present or the mother that is present in your life right now. And you may be present here today, Mama, I love you. I'm not saying anything bad to you, but even if you're an older mother of some of the single daughters of this church and you're here today, you are a father as well. And it is imperative that you speak words of encouragement and endorsement. Let your daughter be healed. And you may say to me, well, the culture is the culture. I don't care what the culture says. This is the culture here.
Amen.
This supersedes all blood. This supersedes all culture. Amen.
Amen.
And as a result of this, this is why I push and plead the way I do, to always speak words of encouragement to particularly the daughters of Zion, particularly if they're single mothers. The single mothers who are daughters of Zion to speak words of encouragement because I know they've been rejected. So part of being a father is to denounce the rejection. It's the same thing, the hand under the thigh. Now, ladies, that's not for you to do. This is a man thing. Now don't let me hear get a phone call talking about some sister. The pastor said, "Oh, put my hand under your thigh." That's not what I said. But it's in the Bible. It's not what I said. This is for sons who were to receive the blessing. They were to put the hand under to get the blessing. Now, the whole thing about this, with Jacob wrestling with the angel and his hip got broke right near the thigh, was the same thing. What God was doing is bringing him in a position to remind him of the understanding. And Jacob walked like this with a limp for the rest of his life. God never healed me. And you know he could have. Jacob moved in prophetic understanding. Who do you think was the one that prophesied to the 12 tribes of Israel? Every word, go read it. When the sons came before him, he prophesied. Everything that man said to those boys came to pass. He was a prophet. But a father who understood the power of his authority in God.